start entering into a four-week series over the next 5 weeks, just to prepare us for our time together as we move into our launch of our small groups. As Sid already so eloquently shared with us, the value of being in a small group, the value of as the church gets bigger, to find places where it feels a little smaller. Those places where you can have genuine conversation, genuine interaction, and genuine accountability and authenticity with one another are vital so that we grow as individuals. It's not sufficient for a church to grow as an organization alone. It's necessary for its growth also to be reflected in its individuals. I'm not interested in growing a big church. A big church is the result of big people. And that's our dream, is to grow big people. We're not interested in just growing a big group. We want to grow big people. And what's been happening is, as people have grown in who they are, naturally what happens is the nature of who they are rubs off on other people, and people want to know why they are the way that they are, and it's simply because of the people that they're rubbing shoulders with. And so as we grow, you know, you're part of the group on Sunday, but you're part of the church in small groups, because that's where the deep things and the discipleship and the real shift can happen. And so the way that we're structured for our small group ministry is for the first 4 weeks, every group the first 4 weeks of the 10-week window, every group will kind of review what's being spoken. Now, some of the groups continue to do that. Other groups have their own agendas, and that's all fine. But for this first little bit, we walk together in just establishing cultural norms, cultural elements. And what I want to talk about the gospel. I want to talk about what it is to be a part of the beloved, and I'd like to bring some clarity as how we at Gateway are going to walk together this way. Now, for some of this might seem like a bit of a review for you. For some of you, others, for you, this might be the first time you hear it. That's fine. But there's a necessity in the body of Christ to walk in as much revelation as we possibly can in the nature of the gospel. And in the nature of the covenant that was given to us, it's of paramount responsibility in the body of Christ to do this, because we reflect and we relay the message of the gospel to the measure that we have revelation about it. What you share will be what you share with the world will be to the measure of what you understand you've been given in the covenant. That's why it's of vital importance that as believers we passionately pursue a spirit of wisdom and revelation, the Holy Spirit, so that we engage the fullness of the gospel. Because our message is so much more than just change the way you live and become a Christian. And the gospel is so much more than a new set of rules. We're not exchanging one prison cell for a smaller one. But sadly, because of the way the spirit of religion has tricked us into sharing the gospel with the world, there's the belief that those of us who are Christians, we live this more restricted life. Well, why would I ever want to do that? I want to have life and life abundantly, and what you're offering me sounds like rules and rules abundantly, and I'm not interested. But the message that we receive will be the message that we give. Now, this might seem a little bit of a silly statement, but it's of vital importance, and it's on the screen behind me, and it says this: the cross, without the cross, there is no gospel. Without the cross, there is no gospel. Said another way, without a covenant, there is no gospel. Without a covenant, there is no good news. The cross is the central point of history. Without it, there's nothing that's good for us. The cross, history rests on the fulcrum of the cross. And so often the gospel gets reduced to a salvation message, and it's so much more than that. When Jesus spoke, he said, "And this gospel of the kingdom will be proclaimed throughout the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come." The gospel of the kingdom, this is the good news of the king's domain. This is the good news of the kingdom of God. When Jesus said, "Repent, For the kingdom of God is at hand. What he was saying is the good news, the way of the kingdom. There's a new sheriff in town, and it's the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and he is setting up the game so that you always win. This is the good news of the kingdom. But without the cross, there is no good news. Now, you and I are meant to be children of the covenant that we've been given. We're meant to be children of the covenant. We have to, while we are best described as Christians, Christ ones, anointed ones, because Christ literally means anointed, we're also children of a covenant. We are the result of a covenant. My children, my natural children, are the result of a covenant. And we are a result of a covenant. Am I making sense this morning? Okay, come with me because I want to, now, so what is a covenant? Now, Malcolm Smith has a very wordy definition, and one of the reasons why I'm going back to this is that there's been a few times where people have said to me, Landon, when you say covenant, I'm still not sure what you mean by that, and that's fine. So today I want to bring some clarity to this, and this is why we're discussing it in our home group, so that we come to a corporate clarity as to what we're saying when we say covenant. He writes this, a binding, unbreakable obligation between two parties based on unconditional love, sealed by blood and sacred oath, that creates a relationship in which each party is bound by specific undertakings on each other's behalf. The parties to the covenant place themselves under the penalty of divine retribution should they later attempt to avoid these undertakings. It's a relationship that can only be broken by death. Okay, that's a little wordy, hard to memorize that. It's not on the exam. But basically what he's saying is that it's a binding, unbreakable promise between two parties. A covenant is not a legal contract. It's not the exchange of activities based on performance. It's the laying down of our lives for one another. I'd like for us, for our purposes, for covenant to be defined as this. An unbreakable promise because of unconditional love. Unbreakable and unconditional. An unbreakable promise because of unconditional love. To fully engage the nature of the covenant, we have to look at it from a biblical perspective. Because when we look at covenant based on what we perceive from our modern perspective, we naturally think about legal contracts. That's the way that we naturally kind of look at it. Furthermore, even today, the very things that are meant to be representative of what the nature of covenant is like, a thing like marriage, has been reduced to a simple contract that can be broken, not necessarily easily, but it certainly can be broken. The nature of covenant, the closest thing that we have to it is when we look at marriage. And so with my covenant with Kath, When we stood before the pastor and he said, you know, to her, do you, and then said, and she said, you know, I do, and then he turned to me and said, do you, and she said, he does, and then we entered into this covenant. What we were declaring is that at her worst, she was going to receive my best. The nature of covenant is that at whoever we're in covenant with, at their worst, they can expect to receive my best. It's their covenant, not just their covenant privilege, but their covenant right to receive my best. Are you with me? An unbreakable promise because of unconditional love. Now, in marriage, I have to manage my love. One of the biggest mistakes I see young couples make and older couples is this, is that they're trying to make the other person manage their personal love. Your performance determines the measure of my personal love that I'm going to give to you. That's what ends up happening when marriages break down. When covenant breaks down, what happens is we move away from laying down our lives for the other person to hoping that the other person will lay down their lives for us. And that's when covenant begins to break down. It's our responsibility. What I often tell couples when they first start this whole journey of marriage is that it's your responsibility to bring the healthiest you can to this union. You are responsible for you, and you have to manage your love for the other person. Now, when we look at God and when we look at the covenant that we're a part of with God, mercy and grace is God managing his love towards us. And holiness as a response is us managing our love towards him. In that, the perspective of permissive grace is broken. Because I'm not truly walking in a revelation of my covenant if I'm satisfied with just leaning into the grace of God without pursuing and managing my love in return through holiness. This isn't to put a religious yoke on us, rather to open us up to the power of love expressed through our lives. God's mercy and his grace is him simply managing his love towards me. And my response is to manage my love towards him, and that looks like holiness. That looks like being set apart. It looks like being in love with him and not in love with the things of the world. So there are three things that I want to kind of talk about this. I'm not going to kind of talk about them. I am going to talk about them. Three things that I'm going to talk about. Two of them, actually, you've heard. The third, you haven't, and I'm going to share it with you this morning. Firstly, covenant needs representatives from each party. The nature of covenant is that there's a representative. Now, the best one that we have in the scripture that I think really makes it clear is David and Goliath. When Goliath, how many here is unfamiliar with David and Goliath? Okay, good. Quickly, if you are, just hang tough. I'll tell you, Goliath was a really big guy. He was a Philistine, and he was the champion of the armies of the Philistines. And he taunted the Israeli armies for 40 days, walking across a field back and forth, shouting insults to them, and saying, "Send out a champion. We'll fight. Why all this bloodshed between two armies? Just send out a champion, and we'll fight." Now, Goliath was like 9 feet tall. And the children of Israel were cowering in their tents, not wanting to fight. A young shepherd boy by the name of David comes to the armies to bring some lunch to his brothers, and he hears this Philistine yelling at the armies of Israel, and he cries out, "Who is this uncircumcised Philistine, shouting down the armies of the Lord Most High?" That term, uncircumcised Philistine, was a more effective insult back in those days, not as much now. Just people's look when I say it to, they don't get it. So I'd suggest you not to do it. So David goes to Saul, the king of the Israelites, and he says, let me go fight him. I'll represent Israel. Which means this, that as David got permission to go out and fight on behalf of Israel, he was the representative of Israel. Goliath was the representative of the Philistines. The armies didn't fight. The two champions were going to fight. The women, the children, the soldiers, the old people, everybody was in David when he went onto the battlefield. When David went onto the battlefield, he was Israel's representative. They were in him. Now, he won the battle. He slew him down, with a slingshot, knocked him down, chopped off his head. And in that, when that victory was won, the armies of Israel rushed over in their victory. You see, Malcolm Smith says it this way, they brought nothing but 6 weeks of cowardice to the battle, but they ran in like they were the victors, because they were. Their representative won the battle on their behalf. So too for us. We were in Christ when he came and took the cross. We were in him. Therefore, his victory is our victory. Meaning that we didn't, nor can we, bring anything of any substance or value to this battle. I am crucified with Christ. Therefore, I no longer live. You see, we were in him. You got to understand this. Not we as the church. Mankind was in Christ. I've shared this marginally, but my favorite movie is one of my favorite movies is Despicable Me. My real favorite movie is Rudy, and if you didn't cry through it, you're heartless and you need deliverance. But Despicable Me is one of my favorite kids' movie, and I love the dastardly criminal, you know, and the little girls that open his heart, and he becomes a good dad to them, and he adopts them, and it's a cute movie. And there's one scene where the little girls are in their orphanage, and they're praying that they would receive some parents. And as they're praying for the parents, the Lord struck me that it's like, and here we are, God sitting in the lobby of mankind's orphanage, waiting for any who would come out and be fathered. And God waits in the lobby, and he's waiting. You know, if you're here today and you haven't come into covenant, if you haven't engaged the gospel, if you haven't let the cross work on your behalf, God is in the lobby of your orphanage just waiting for you to come and choose him, because he's already chosen you. Mankind was in Christ. And because of that, our representative Jesus won a battle that we could never win, fighting in a way that we could never fight, to give us what we could have never obtained on our own strength. The spirit of religion has nothing on the power of covenant. Now, I was in Jesus, just like Israel was in David. He is our representative. What is covenant? There's an eternal element to covenant. There's a connection between the gospel and Genesis. In Genesis chapter 15, Abram is before the Lord, and the Lord calls him to come out of his tent. When Abram is lamenting, you say that I'm going to have, you know, I don't even have an heir. What am I supposed to do? And God takes him out of his tent. He says, look at the stars. He said, your offspring will outnumber the stars. And then in sealing the promise, God, this is in Genesis 15, you can read it, God asks Abram to bring the articles necessary to create a covenant. Now again, thinking in Hebrew, from a Hebrew perspective, thinking from the ancient perspective, one of the ceremonies of covenant was to take animals and cut them in half and set them in their halves so that you would literally walk through death together. And so Abram does what he's told to do. He gets a heifer and a goat and a ram, and he prepares the covenant ceremony, and then he sits and he waits for God. Make no wonder the Bible says that Abram believed and his faith was accounted to him to righteousness. He sat and waited for God to walk through the covenant items together. What an amazing thought. Am I the only one that's struck by that? That's incredible that he had the faith to sit and wait for God. Well, as he's waiting, he's, you know, protecting the carcasses from birds and things like that, and he falls asleep as darkness comes. And in the sleep, a great kind of darkness comes on him, and he begins to see what God is going to do with his offspring. And God tells him about the 400 years of sojourning in another land and about the slavery. And he tells them that he's going to bring them out of the slavery with even more riches than they ever went into it. And God begins to tell him this. And then when Abram awakes, he awakes to see a smoking pot. Not somebody smoking pot with and cauldron, a smoking cauldron vessel and a flame of a flaming torch going through the elements of the covenant. What's this mean? Well, first of all, I want to ask you, remember what the children of Israel were led by? A pillar of cloud and a pillar of fire. And God was foreshadowing how he would lead Abram's descendants out of their bondage. And he was making a covenant with Abram, fully aware that Abram didn't have the capacity to make or keep this covenant himself. So God made the promise to himself. God, in his grace, promised to himself that he would see through what Abram couldn't see through. Here's why. Kathy and I are bound in covenant until one of us dies. And then she's free to spend my money. Remember when I turned 40, I said, I might trade you in for 220s. And she said, you're not wired for 220s. but it's like when she passes away or when I pass away, our covenant is ended because our covenant ends in death. But God knew that Abram was going to die. So he couldn't keep the covenant with him. God knew that Abram wasn't capable to make a covenant, and he wasn't going to set up a covenant that he couldn't keep. So he promised himself. He made a covenant with himself. Now, if we were to fast forward, we know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him, for the death he died to sin once and for all, but the life he lives to God. The great mystery and the wonder of God that's revealed to us in the cross is this, that God the Father representing deity and then God the Son, Jesus, representing humanity, made a promise amongst himself, causing us to be the benefactors of a better covenant. And Jesus, who will never die, is part of the covenant-keeping promise. And frankly, we could never do. I can't guarantee that I'll never die. But God, are you following what I'm saying? The spirit of religion would teach us or trick us into thinking that we are the keepers of our covenant. We are the benefactors of a covenant that's being kept by God the Father and God the Son on our behalf. There is a covenant for mankind that brings life and freedom, wholeness, and an eternal security that is guaranteed by the Father who loves mankind so much that he would send the Son to represent mankind so well that we would never be lost from the grip of the love of God. It's an unbreakable promise because of unconditional love. Children today are left at the mercy of the strength of the covenant of their parents. My children are left at the their well-being is left at the mercy of the strength of my covenant with Kathy. As we know today, there's a lot of children who have ended up growing up on very shaky ground because the covenant between mom and dad wasn't able to be kept. For whatever reason, and I'm not speaking condemnation on anybody who struggled through or went through divorce. What I'm saying is that the breaking of the covenant, children are left vulnerable to the strength of covenant. We are children of the promise. We are children of covenant. We are the children of an unbreakable promise because of unconditional love. We are the children of that, and it is guaranteed because he who made it with him who made it cannot be broken, cannot be shaken, and it cannot be lost. Listen, I don't agree with a doctrine. I don't agree with a once saved, always saved doctrine in the sense of that you can be saved and not bear any responsibility in the way that you live and reflecting holiness to God. I believe that you can turn your back on this covenant. But I would say to you this, unlike some of us who got saved at every, you know, thunder shower, I want to challenge this thought that I believe while it isn't impossible to walk away from your salvation, I believe it's a lot harder to lose it than we think. Because of the great power of the covenant keepers of our gospel. Are you following me this morning? It's an unbreakable promise because of unconditional love. Jesus is our perfect representative, sinless like we could never be, eternal like we could never be, perfect like we could never be, and able like we were never able. To be a sacrifice that we could never be, so that we could have all that he has as an inheritance. This is the power of the cross. This is the power of the good news. This is what we're a part of. Jesus is our representative, died as us and for us, so we could benefit from a better covenant. Listen to what it says in Hebrews chapter 6, or chapter, wherever it is, 8, verse 6. But as it is, Christ has obtained a ministry that is much more excellent than the old, as the covenant he mediates is better, since he's enacted it on better promises. What is a covenant? Covenant has a representative, the covenant is eternal, and finally, the covenant is a covenant of acceptance. Another picture of the covenant that we're a part of is shown to us through David and Mephibosheth. David, before he became king, was best friends with the son of the then king, Saul. His name was Jonathan. David and Jonathan loved each other as brothers. They made a covenant to one another that there would be peace between their households. They didn't need a covenant for themselves. They wanted this covenant so that their families and their households would love and honor one another over the years. And when David was finally brought into being the king, it was at the cost of the death of Saul, and Jonathan died as well. In that day, of course, it's a brutal day, and if you were part of the royal lineage, and you went from being royalty to a threat to the next king. And so what would normally happen is that anybody of the former royal lineage would be slaughtered so that the new king wouldn't have any competition or any fear of rebellion or people rising up representing an old kingdom. So when news came to Jerusalem that Jonathan had died and that David was on his way to ascend to the throne, when that happened, Jonathan's household went into a panic. And one of the young sons, his name was Mephibosheth, who was just a toddler at the time, was being rushed out of the house by his nurse, and she tripped and dropped him and crippled him. And in his crippling, so he lived crippled for the rest of his life, but they took him in hiding. So he was in hiding and crippled. Hiding from this king. Now listen, he would have been brought into that situation being taught that David was a usurper, that David would kill him. Being taught that David had robbed him of his royal lineage, that David had robbed him of his throne, of his possessions, of his place in history. That the line of the kings was being broken because of this rebel David. He would have been taught to hate him. He would have been taught to fear him. He would have been taught that David was going to, given the opportunity, murder him and put him out of any form of competition to the throne. David, after he ascends to the throne, remembers his covenant with Jonathan. And he asks, is there anybody who's still of the house of Jonathan that I can show kindness to? Now, there's lots of messages around this story, but I want you to catch this one part. David finds out about Mephibosheth, and he sends for him. Now, I can't imagine what that would have felt like to hear the king has found you out, and he's called for you. Basically, I think Mephibosheth is thinking this: as I get to the throne, I'll get to see the throne room, and then that'll be it. I'll be murdered in front of the king. And he's brought before the king. And when he's brought before the king, the first words that David say are this: don't be afraid, for I surely will show you the same kindness that I showed your father Jonathan. David delighted in Mephibosheth in the same way that he would have delighted in Jonathan. We, like Mephibosheth, are left lame and in hiding in our broken circumstances outside of the covenant. We're left in a place where we're broken and left in our sin nature without any hope of freedom whatsoever. But then the Father, remembering his covenant with the Son, reminds somebody amongst his children to share that covenant with you. And the Holy Spirit awakens your heart. Tell him I'm a little busy. The Holy Spirit awakens your heart to your need for love. All the areas that you may have searched for it, all the things you might have done to find it, all of a sudden seem to fall like ash in your mouth when you discover that there is real love that you can walk in, that you can know, that you can be held fast in. And as that's awakened in your heart, you're enabled to come before the King. The King who maybe the spirit of religion had told you that you're not good enough to be in front of. The King that maybe the spirit of religion had told you that he wants to kill you. The King that maybe the spirit of religion has taught you that you should be afraid of. The media, the people, the lies that have said that this God isn't who he says he is, that this God is wanting to hurt you, that this God, this King, is looking forward to put his thumb on you and to crush you and to be done with you because of the fact that you hold this that your stench in his nostrils because you're not good enough. Only to discover that when you're brought before this King of love, that he delights in you in the same way that he delights in Jesus. It's an unbreakable promise of unconditional love. This is the covenant. This is the covenant. This good news of the covenant of the kingdom is so outrageously tipped in our favor that the only appropriate response to it is worship. I have a song I'd like the team to cue up to play, please. If you want to just bring the lights down, and I'd like you to prepare yourselves and go ahead and play this.
I used to shake it like an 8-ball. I used to shoot you like a gun. I used to hold you like a hammer. Tried to nail down everyone. I used to keep you in a steeple. I used to bind you in a book. I used to take it like prescription. Without knowing what I took. And now I just don't buy it anymore. No, I try and I try to know everything for sure. But I find I know less as I come to know you more. You're not who I thought. I don't think everybody's right. I think we often get it wrong. I think that when we get to heaven, we're gonna laugh when we can see how hard we tried to make it and how easy it should be. And so I just don't buy it. Fear is no good reason to believe in anything. And so I
I've been a believer for a long, long time. Worship team, would you come and join me, please? And just leave the lights down low, everybody. It's just let it be kind of a private moment. I've been a believer for a long, long time. Sad to say that the majority of that time, frankly, lived very afraid of God. Afraid that the covenant that I was a part of depended on me. I'm a player in it, but it doesn't depend on me. He did it all. I'm a benefactor of it. Tried to convince people that through fear they could come to a loving God, and it's just never really worked. And it breaks my heart to confess that for so many years I was prohibited by the spirit of religion from truly entering into grace. Grace that set me free. Not to permissively live my life and not reflect any sort of responsibility to my discipleship. I think we're mature enough to understand. But pursuing holiness and pursuing God out of a fear of letting him down and then letting him down, feeling like he might let me go. And I just don't buy it anymore. Because I've come to learn that I know less when I come to know him more. He's not who I thought he was. Praise the Lord. If you're here today and you're just starting to discover that he's not who you thought he was, and you just want to praise him, I want you to stand. Whatever you guys want to do. And we're going to take a moment and we're just going to worship him. Maybe you're here and you're asking, God, I need a revelation that you're not who I thought you were. Then I want you to stand too. Maybe you're here and you're thinking that you're not worthy to stand. I've got such good news for you. The one who gave you the right to stand was worthy on your behalf. You can stand because you're allowed to come just as you are. But he's not going to leave you just where you are. And all over this place, I want you to respond in an attitude of what would be appropriate, which is to worship him who gave you such an unbalanced gift. So just take a moment, and if you need to declare it, say, you're not who I thought you were. Praise the Lord. I worship you. Go ahead, team. Take us up.